Hi, I'm Aurélien Géron, and today I'm going to explain how to get reproducible outputs with TensorFlow. The goal is to ensure that every time you run your program with some inputs A, you get the same outputs B, the same predictions, the same models, the same everything. Always exactly the same outputs B. This sounds easy enough, but unfortunately, it's actually surprisingly tricky. For example, TensorFlow executes operations in parallel when it can. Depending on how fast each thread runs, operation A may finish before or after operation B. That's not a problem as long as the outputs of these operations are used in a deterministic order. But suppose they are pushed to the same queue, then the order of the items in that queue may change every time you run your program, and so will the downstream operations. In some cases, you might think that the order doesn't matter, because mathematically the result should be the same. For example, 2 times 5 divided by 7 should be equal to 2 divided by 7 times 5. But because we are using floats with limited precision, we do not get the exact same results. During training, these tiny differences will accumulate, and you may end up with pretty different outputs in the end. You can try to make your code deterministic despite being multi-threaded, but it's going to be hard work. Actually, since GPUs rely heavily on parallelism to achieve high performance, it's extremely hard to get perfectly reproducible results when you use TensorFlow on a GPU. TensorFlow is based on NVIDIA's CUDA library to control the GPU through the kubelis and cuDNN libraries. They contain high-performance functions for many linear algebra and neural network operations. These functions break down the computations into many small chunks that are run in parallel across hundreds of GPU threads. This is precisely what GPUs are good at. It's what makes them so fast. Now, some CUDA functions are careful about the order of execution, so they have reproducible outputs. But others trade off a bit of precision for a big increase in performance. TensorFlow uses some of these high-performance functions in many cases, which means that if you use them, your code will be fast, but not perfectly reproducible. For example, if you use tf-reduce-sum or reduce-mean, the outputs are going to vary across runs. But tf.matmul is reproducible. And if you build a convolutional layer, its outputs will not be perfectly reproducible, and so on. The bottom line is that, in general, it's going to be very hard to get perfectly reproducible outputs using TensorFlow on a GPU. You would have to be very careful about which functions you use, and even then, TensorFlow might use tf.reduce-sum when computing the gradients. Some researchers at 2 Sigma have pulled it off. I'll leave a link in the video description. But it's only for some kinds of neural networks, so in general, I would advise against using TensorFlow on a GPU if you really want reproducible results. Note that PyTorch has an option to use only the deterministic functions, so it's much easier to get reproducible outputs on a GPU with PyTorch than with TensorFlow. That said, if you activate this option, your code will run much, much slower. Another reason why it's hard to make TensorFlow programs deterministic is because neural networks rely heavily on stochasticity, or randomness. The model parameters are initialized randomly, and then gradient descent selects random batches of training data at each iteration, reducing the model error gradually until convergence. But if you run the program multiple times, the final model parameters will be slightly different every time. Okay, so what are the steps required to make your program reproducible? Step 1. Unfortunately, I don't recommend you use a GPU. If you don't have a GPU, or you installed the CPU-only version of TensorFlow rather than GPU version, then you're fine. If not, you can set the CUDA visible devices environment variable to an empty string, either before the program starts like this, or within your program like that. But make sure you set it before a TensorFlow session is created. Another option is to explicitly pin every operation to the CPU by using a tf.device block like this. Step 2. Unfortunately, you should avoid multi-threading if you want reproducible results. So to make TensorFlow single-threaded, you must create a config proto and set the number of intra-op and inter-op threads to 1, then use this config proto when creating a session. By default, the first session you create will build the thread pools that will be shared by all sessions, So make sure the very first session you create has this configuration. In fact, you could just create a session like this at the beginning of your program and close it right away, and that's it. All new sessions will be single-threaded. This is useful in particular if you use the Keras API or the Estimators API, since they manage their own sessions. Step 3, set all the random seeds. First, you need to set the Python hash seed environment variable to 0 before you start your program. This is used by Python for certain hash-based functions, for example, to determine the order of items in sets and dictionaries. For example, you can set it on the command line like this, but don't try to set it within your program. It won't work because Python reads this environment variable upon startup. By the way, you can also set this variable when starting a Jupyter server, and all notebooks will have this environment variable set. Next, you want to set the random seeds for the random number generators in Python, NumPy, and TensorFlow. You also need to set the seeds of any other library you may use. TensorFlow's random seed should be set at the beginning of your program, but also every time you reset the default graph. This includes when you call Keras's clear session function. Make sure you set the seed before you create the first random operation, not just before it's evaluated. If you create a graph, you need to set its own random seed as well. If you use the Estimators API, make sure to create a run config with its TF random seed argument set, then pass it to the constructor when creating an estimator. If you use the NumPy input function, then make sure to set its shuffle argument to false, because unfortunately it does not let you set the seed and it uses a random one, at least up to TensorFlow version 1.10. In this case, you probably want to shuffle the dataset yourself before training. However, shuffling will only happen once, not before each epoch, so it's not ideal. A better option is to create your own input function using the data API, like this. The important point here is to set the random seed when calling the shuffle function. You can pause the video if you want to take a closer look. Finally, step 4, make sure you eliminate any other source of variability in your program. For example, if you read files from disk, you should make sure their contents are always the same, of course, but you should also make sure you always use them in the same order. For example, the listdir function returns files in an order that depends on how they are indexed on the file system, so you should sort this list before you use it. And that's about it. We got rid of the main sources of variability. In general, this will be sufficient to make your TensorFlow programs perfectly reproducible. But since it will only run on a single thread on the CPU, it's probably going to be much slower. So you might be wondering why you would need perfect reproducibility in the first place. Does it really matter if your model's accuracy varies by a fraction of a percent every time you train it on the same dataset? Well, in general, no, but there are cases where it does matter. Let me give you a few examples. First, you might want perfect reproducibility for regression testing. Suppose you refactor your program or you update some libraries it depends on. You really don't expect the outputs to be affected. But suppose you feed the inputs A and you get some unexpected outputs C. How can you tell whether the change came from the updates you made to the code or whether it just came from the program's normal variability? If the program was reproducible, you would know that the unexpected outputs were a result of your code changes. Another use case is for debugging. Suppose you get some really weird outputs. Your program has a bug and you need to find it. But when you start to investigate, the outputs are sometimes normal and sometimes buggy. If you could ensure that your program always produces the same outputs, it would be much easier to locate bugs. Another reason why you might care about perfect reproducibility is when you want to share an experiment with your colleagues, and you want them to be able to get the exact same results as you did. Or maybe you're doing a live demo and you want to make sure you don't get bad results in front of the audience. Okay, to conclude, making your TensorFlow program reproducible is a bit tricky and it will badly degrade performance, but there are some use cases where it can be useful. However, in most cases, you can live with a non-deterministic program, as long as the variations are small enough. In fact, you will learn more about your deep learning model if you train it multiple times rather than just once. You could measure its performance at each run and compute the mean and standard deviation. This will give you a better idea of how good or bad your model really is, and also how stable it is during training. If you notice that the performance varies a lot, you should probably try to fix that, for example, by checking for signs of overfitting, maybe adding some regularization to your model like dropout or batch normalization, and so on. I've created a Jupyter Notebook to demonstrate how to write reproducible code in TensorFlow. I encourage you to check it out. The link is in the video description. And that's all I had. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please like, subscribe, and click on the bell to be notified when I upload a new video. And please don't hesitate to post comments below. If you want to learn more about deep learning, check out my book, Hands-on Machine Learning with Scikit-learn and TensorFlow. You can also read it in Russian, Korean, French, Japanese, and German. Thanks for watching, and see you next time. Okay, you're still here. Oh, so there are a few bonus slides about graph seeds and operation seeds. Suppose you created a graph with a random operation A. You create a session and start a loop that evaluates the random op. This produces a random sequence. If you restart the program and run it again, or you just run it in a new session, you will get a different sequence. If you create a second random operation, it will also generate a different sequence. Now, if you set the graph seed, the random sequences will be reproducible across multiple runs, but the sequences A and B will be different. This is because the actual seed used by TensorFlow to generate random numbers is actually a combination of the graph seed and the operation ID. If you set both the graph seed and the operation seed, then the final seed is a combination of both. If you get the same seed for operation B, it will produce the same sequence as operation A. If you create another operation C with a different seed, it will generate a different sequence. And that's it. Bye-bye.